Good morning, everybody. One trademark of a successful business organization is growth. Wahoo's Fish Taco is certainly indicative of that. Starting their entrepreneurial endeavor with their first Wahoo's Fish Taco in Costa Mesa, California, the restaurant company has experienced extraordinary growth over the past 25 years and now serves restaurant patrons in more than 60 locations throughout California, Texas, Nevada, Nebraska, New York, on Park Avenue, no less, and Hawaii. And we'll talk a little bit about that location later. Wing is nationally recognized. I'm sure a few of you would like that too as well. Wing is nationally recognized for his innovative marketing strategies and for his expertise in entrepreneurship. He is a sought-after speaker and lecturer and serves as an adjunct professor. He is also a passionate philanthropist and an active supporter of a variety of charitable and community-based organizations. We continue Cal Southern's tradition of bringing you valuable, educational, and insightful presentations through our Master Lecture Series. Through the Master Lecture Series, we reach learners and people all over the world. Today, for example, we have people attending our Master Lecture Series from all across the United States, Canada, Mexico, Pakistan, India, the United Arab Emirates, Vietnam, Singapore, South Africa, Namibia, and Tanzania, just to name a few. So without further ado, California Southern University and the School of Business takes great pride in introducing to you and everyone throughout the world watching a Southern California original, an entrepreneur extraordinaire, Mr. Wing Lam.
Seafood industry.
It's been fun turning a passion into a business.
We'll take the shocking journey to a devastated coast.
We lost our house. There's just nothing.
I'm homeschooling my kids because I can't afford to put them in school.
Whose fishing industry has been crippled by one of the worst oil spills in history.
We was closed for about a year. We couldn't work.
11 died.
Oh, wow.
I never dreamed of it affecting us.
He'll be forced to witness the hardships he's avoided.
I've been homeless off and on for about 5 years.
This is where I stay.
It's really hard to see people suffering.
And hear incredible stories of survival.
It takes some caring people who are willing to sacrifice.
I ain't gonna give up that easy.
Before he reveals himself as...
I thought I'd leave something behind.
Oh my gosh!
There's not enough money in the world to tell you how good I really felt.
The Secret Millionaire.
Just to give you a quick little history, which is kind of funny, is I'm not originally from Southern California. I'm originally from Brazil. So that's what makes this really an interesting story, because there are three Asian kids right here that shouldn't be running a Mexican-themed restaurant. But, you know, only in California. So if it can be done, right? So if I can do it, trust me, you guys can do anything you want. So to kind of give you guys, at least, you know, make sure you guys are awake, do me one little pleasure. We're going to start with a little exercise. And for the people around the world, think of anything else, a local team, because I'm going to start with the California Angels or the Anaheim Angels of Los Angeles, whatever it's called these days, right? The Angels, right? So that's our home team right here. So wherever you are around the world, imagine wherever your home team is, and just kind of, you know, kind of just participate as much as you can. So the first thing I want to ask you guys, just to kind of give you guys the history of how my company builds our brand, I'm going to ask you guys to join me. How many of you guys, please stand up if you've ever been to an Angels game? Okay, the other guys, have you been to a Dodgers game? Okay, come on, we gotta make sure that you've been to a game, okay? So the whole idea is, you know, most of us have been to a ball game, right? So how many of you stay standing, okay, if you actually sat down in a lower level of a game? Remain standing. See, that's pretty good, right? Because most people, if they don't have a lot of money, you're up in the nosebleed. So the better, the closer you are to the field, the better the experience, okay? Now, let's keep standing if you've actually been on the field of the Angel Stadium. Okay, so we got a few guys left, right? Because maybe you knew somebody. Now let's try a little bit more harder now. I'm still standing, right? How many of you guys have ever thrown a first pitch at Angel Stadium? Remain standing. Okay, there's nobody left standing. I'm still standing, right? But if, let's just amuse me here. Tom, stand up for a second. So assume you've taken the first pitch. The next question would be, how many of you have taken batting practice at Angel Stadium? See, I'm still standing, right? So the whole deal is, why are we talking about this? Because in building a brand, well, the way I figured out is how to make people's lives better, right? So whatever it is that you're doing right now and around the world, what is it that you do at your core business? Are you an accountant? Are you an attorney? Are you an engineer? The reason you are better than everybody else in your field is because you become the go-to person because you make your clients' lives better. Think about that, right? Because when I started my business, how many Mexican restaurants are there in Southern California? A bunch. It's not like I was the first guy 25 years ago. There are probably hundreds 25 years ago. There's probably thousands today. So what makes me so special, right? Well, because I figured out if I can take Mexican food, change it a little bit, add a little Brazilian influence, add a little bit of the Asian influence, right? And cater to a market that hasn't had anybody taking care of them. The surf industry, right? Think about it, right? I become the guy that makes their lives better. And how would that be? Okay, so let's assume, I see everybody here is in a suit or something very well, nicely dressed. So when you want to take your significant other to celebrate, you probably go to maybe a nice Italian restaurant, maybe a French, maybe Chinese, maybe whatever it is. And you drop a few hundred dollars and it's a great meal. Now think about that. Would I go to Wahoo's to do the same? Probably not, because price point, your significant other is gonna say, well, gee, I appreciate the food is really good. We're not talking about the food not being good, but we're trying to celebrate here something. So $20 is nice for lunch, $100 is nice for dinner, right? It's relative. Now let's take that to the beach. 25 years ago, surf contest. Does anybody here surf? We got one. As a kid, tell me if I'm wrong, your mom packed your lunch the night before to drop you to the surf contest. That means that the little peanut butter or bologna sandwich, 25 years ago we're talking about, right, before paninis and all this other stuff was in existence, chances are they probably didn't even toast your bread, right? They slap whatever is in there, right? They put it in the brown bag, and you can't have sandwich without a soda, so they probably put a can of pop on top, and maybe a fruit, an orange or an apple. So by the next day, your sandwich, though, used to be about this thick, is probably about this. A little soggy maybe, right? So you got up at 5 in the morning, you got down to the beach, you surfed your contest, and what do you get rewarded with? The soggy bologna or peanut butter or turkey sandwich. Now, remember, we're talking about celebration, right? To you as a 12-year-old, a 14-year-old, 16-year-old, this is your moment. This is it. You just won your little heat, whatever you did, you're celebrating life, right? Just as we do as adults, as an anniversary, right? And this is what you get rewarded with. How did I make these surfers' lives better? I asked them, how would you like for me as a sponsor of your event? Remember, my job is to make the event better, their lives. I'll be down at the beach, I'll bring the barbecue, I'll set up some chafing dishes, and we'll have some fresh, hot fish tacos with rice and beans. Imagine, right? You got up at 5, you did all this. Now, even better than the kid, the mom who had to drive everybody down there. I said, come on in, you're part of the event. The mom is like, oh my God, I didn't have to go spend more money. I get a hot free meal. This is kind of cool. And remember, before I came along, you as a parent got zero. You have to freeze your little behind off on the beach, right? And you don't understand the first thing about surfing anyway. The waves are way out there. You can't really see it, right? And you're there going, this is sucks, right? Now imagine me at lunchtime, I show up, boom, and you're like, this is awesome. This is filet mignon compared to what you're used to, right? So imagine I did it for one company. Back then it was the number two company in the world called Billabong USA. Guess what happens? The quick server guy goes, dude, my kids that just surfed in that contest told me that our contests suck because we got peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. Billabong's contest was awesome because they had Wahoos. There I am, right? So I made the surf contest better, right? Then we get into skateboarding because all surfers have friends that skate. All friends that skate have friends that snowboard, right? So all of a sudden, people get the word, there's this Asian guy in Costa Mesa who's willing to drive up to the mountains, to the skate parks, to the beaches, wherever we are, and make our lives better. Where should we go to eat and spend our money in order that we can keep having the same experience over and over again? Right? I didn't go down to the beach and say, hey guys, you guys are going to be done with your surf contest. When you're done on your way home, come to my restaurant. That would have never worked. That's what most of you guys do, right? You want the sales, but you're not thinking about how you make their lives better. If you make their lives better first, it's almost like they feel obligated, because guess what? Think about it in your time right here. I can think about when I was a junior lifeguard, and I remember that no matter where I was around Newport, I would run down to Perry's Pizza and buy a slice of pizza for 50 cents. Because it was the reward for a whole day running around the beach, right? And to this day, there's no other pizza that quite tastes like that, no matter how gourmet they are, because it's the experience and the reward. And you guys have those favorite restaurants that you celebrate, you go to a restaurant that you go with your significant other every year, right? So you take the little surfer, nobody cared, right? Then this thing called the OP Pro becomes the US Open, the biggest surf contest on the planet. Guess who the go-to guy is still today? Me, right? You skating? Who cared about that? Today you have the X Games. Guess the go-to guy for that is still it, right? So I've done every major, skate, surf, snow, and every other sport in between, because then you have engines that go with it, right? You have motorcycles, supercross, you name it, every world champion that's been around. Their main sponsors in Southern California. Kawasaki is US headquarters right here. Yamaha, Honda, they're all here. This is where everything happens. So I become the go-to guy. And then think about all this, right? You can't do anything in the action sports industry without a soundtrack, because everybody's got videos. Think about that too. Little bands, I was there helping them. Little bands are touring the world today. You know, I joke with people. Remember we had a question about a concert. Probably the best seat in the house for a concert is probably like within the pit area or the front row. But how nice is it to be able to text somebody who's on the in the front row, tell them, goes, those seats are great. Imagine you guys are all in the front row and you guys are all watching Green Day at Verizon Amphitheater, probably one of the biggest bands touring the world right now. And I'm telling you, this is awesome that you're right there. But guess what? My seats are better. And he's like, there's no way, because you can't be in front of me. I'm in the front row. But I'm here on the stage with the band. Imagine that. Why? Because I made Green Day's lives better way back then. Today I get to share. So we go back to the fun thing about the Angels, right? So I tell a great story. The year that the Angels won the World Series, okay? I got asked, and this is where the charity world comes in. Remember, not only do I make everybody's lives better, I think about charity. How do I make your charity more profitable? Again, that makes your life better because you got more money to service more clients, find the cure, whatever it is that you're doing, I'm gonna make it better. I get a phone call from my printer. Hey, I have this shelter, Laurel's house, and we'd like a little bit of help. I'm like, no problem. I'd be happy to come and help out. So I go, hey, can you send us your logo? I'm like, you don't need it. You have it. You're my printer. Great. I'm going to send the little invitation, save the date. Is that okay? I'm like, sure. We're going to put your name, Wahoo's Fish Taco, the big logo right there, wherever that logo is, on the back side of the save the date postcard. And on the back side will be the name of the tournament. I'm like, great. No problem. Go ahead and send it. Hopefully I got this right thing. Okay. So little did I know, I was going to be presenting the Tim Salmon Golf Tournament. The tournament had been around for 3 years before I joined. But I wasn't told it was for Tim Salmon. I was just told it was for Laurel's house, was the benefactor. So as soon as I see this, I'm like, holy cow, right? How do I make this better? What can I do to help Tim Salmon? I mean, come on, you just won the World Series. You're the most popular player on the planet right now in Southern California, right? So I go through the books, and I notice that the most I'd ever made in the tournament was $25,000. I'm like, 25? That's it? And everybody on the committee goes, are you crazy? That's a lot of money. He goes, yes, it is, in relative terms. But with a guy who just won the World Series, that's nothing. And I said, I'm going to make my goal that if we can at least double this, I shouldn't be the title sponsor of this tournament. So without using my money, I called everybody I knew with one simple question, just like I asked you guys to stand up before. How many of you guys got to see the World Series? Everybody they couldn't get tickets. How many of you guys would like to meet Tim Salmon? Everybody stood up. I'm like, okay, all you gotta do is come support this event. And I will guarantee that I will get you a photo opportunity, 5 seconds with Tim, an autograph, whatever it is that you need, if you come to the tournament. We sold the tournament out. At the tournament, we didn't just double the amount, we tripled the amount. And I got asked right after they won the World Series. The tournament was 2 months later. And the question is, how did you do it? As soon as I found out it was Tim, I said, Tim, I got one favor to ask you. Why do people spend money at charities? One, because they have somebody who's benefiting from it, somebody in their family's got the disease, something where they have a direct reason to be involved. 90% of the other people are friends of somebody. They're there to support them. And what makes my life easier is, would you please spend 3 seconds with the people spending the money? Tim goes, done. He goes, if you can do that, I'll take care of the rest. So let's talk about Tim now, because now he's retired. He's an announcer, right? He does the home games, about half the home games for the Angels. So what has happened since I've been involved with him, right? So, because I love the Angels, right? I think it's hilarious, right? Whenever you do a deal with them, right, as part of your sponsorship, you get a player to be named later that you get to meet and do a corporate event with. And I can tell you, you can't pick the player to be named later. That's why it's called a player to be named later, right? It's normally a rookie. If you're lucky, you might have gotten Mike Trout when he was a rookie. But the odds of you getting a guy like that are probably zero and none. You probably get somebody who's kind of like, you know, kind of new to the organization, and part of his duties, civic duties, is to entertain some corporate sponsors. So unless you are the big, your name is on top of the building, the odds of you getting to meet Tim Salmon or somebody of that caliber is zero and none. So we've had a great relationship, and one of the great trips that I've done with him and my brother and two other CEOs, is about 7 years ago, the Super Bowl was in Arizona. They built a brand new stadium in Chandler. Tim lives part of the year, full time, in Scottsdale. So I told Tim, goes, in a nutshell, is we're gonna come out, we need a place to stay, and we did all this around charity, and we're gonna need a car. Tim goes, you can stay at their house, you can borrow either the Escalade, the Suburban, or the Mercedes. You can't take the Ferrari out. I'm like, okay, because we need a 4-seater. And pretty much we'll be able to go to any party we want. So through charity, again, it didn't suck to be good friends with Tim. Okay? So what else do we have?
Be a good title for a book.
Good, yes. And then also, I helped him when he came out with his book about 4 or 5 years ago. I did about 5 stops. The book tour with him was awesome. The lines of people at Costco, Barnes & Noble, whatever, was awesome. So this is where it all started for me, right? When I started the business, Tom Curran was the reigning US world champion. 3-time whatever. He was the guy. You talk about a reason to be in business. He was a reason. I wanted to meet this guy. So not only do I get to meet him, we became lifelong friends. Every surf world title guy in sense, it's been a friend of mine. Mike Ness, a local band member, Social D, has been a great friend as well. And again, these are events where these guys are being honored at. We raise a ton of money. I mean, there's little Tom, you know, we get a lot of autograph stuff. But it's just kind of fun, because if somebody again told me, you're going to open a restaurant so you can meet this guy, I'm like, well, that's kind of one of the things I want to do. You know, and today, literally, his wife, his kids, we're all friends. We go out all the time. And these are the things that you set out to do, and it just kind of has a way of kind of fulfilling. Okay, in building the next part is, there's this little kid, Ryan Sheckler. To the average person, if you don't skateboard, not a big deal. But one of the best reality shows that came out of Orange County about 5 or 6 years ago was called The Life of Ryan. It was following the skateboarder around. The joke was, if you were a fan and you wanted to find Ryan, you just camped outside of the Wahoos in San Clemente. He was there every day. It was hilarious. I had no idea who this kid was, because I think at the time it was like either 15 or 16 years old, but it was the number one reality show on MTV at the time. So I'm like, okay, I find out, somebody tells me, do you realize you're on MTV almost every day? I'm like, what are you talking about? Well, there's this kid that goes there. I'm like, great, so we should do something. Well, it turns out that, again, the kids today are very, again, philanthropic. He started a foundation to take care of autistic kids. So I said, hey, let's work together here. So along with that, you know, we get to do all kinds of TV celebrity appearances there, because I've helped another big Asian organization. And one of the byproducts of helping any organization is their members, again, feel obligated to say, hey, if there's ever an opportunity for us to do something back to you guys. So almost every station in Southern California has a news anchor that has one Asian guy on it. There's Frank Buckley, right? Michaela. So David Ono, Fukasaki, I can go through the whole list, 8, 2, 4, 5, 7, 9, 11, 13. There's one Asian guy, maybe one black guy, just, there's always one, right? It's just part of the equal, you know, movement. You know, we're good, we're all equal opportunities here.
Don't leave the females out either.
Well, no, we gotta have one female in there as well. And then maybe there's one, you know, Caucasian guy as well. But anyway, we have a lot of fun. So these are, again, people, our segments. Most people, when they get to go on the news, they get their little 2 seconds, boom, and you're out of here. Because of my relationship, again, building this way before I knew that this is the byproduct of it, it's been great. The food opportunities, again, talking about our 25th anniversary. I mean, I've been on this about every station under the sun. Now let's talk about, see, if there were any, if I was in New York, then this would be the perfect, right? Quarterback. Tony Hawk. Most crazy skater on the planet. The deal is, I knew him way back when he wasn't Tony Hawk as we know him today. The guy's made hundreds of millions selling video games. Not so much on the actual skateboarding end of it. He made a little bit. But the bulk of it, he made a deal with Sony. Don't pay me for anything. Just give me a dollar from every video you sell. Hundreds of millions of copies later, times a dollar is hundreds of millions. Made a bundle of money. One of the smartest guys you meet. So we did. I'll show you what we did with him. Mark Sanchez, another local hero, and I tell this story. Obviously, we're at a different university here, but almost the same letters for USC, right? So when I go to my beloved lectures at USC, I ask the same question: how many guys have been to a game? Boom! Everybody stands up. As soon as I ask, how many people have been out on the field? A few people sit down. And then my next question is, how many of you guys have ever played catch with either Carson Palmer, Matt Leiner, Mark Sanchez, or Matt Barkley? Nobody's standing up again. I've done it with all four of them, and I didn't go to USC. So this fun stuff, because again, I do all their charity stuff. Okay, we'll talk about product. This is the thing in life about, you can't do it all yourself. So one of the things that I learned early on is, if you're trying to find a solution, right, they talk about there's no I in team and all that fun stuff. Totally 100% true. But surround yourself with people that add, not take. Because you can only create synergy if people bring energy. You don't want to be in a group where everybody comes and goes, what are you going to do for us? It's instead of, what are we going to do together? Okay? So I learned early on that in a study group in college, if I was the one smart Asian kid in the group, and I allowed and enabled 4 or 5 other kids to show up half hungover, we're never gonna get an A in our project, right? So find the guys, the strengths and the weaknesses, what is it that you lack in the team? So Vans, this is wonderful Steve Van Doren. His family started Vans. They're one of the oldest skateboard shoe apparel companies in the world. We've had a ton of fun doing some great events together. This year, they were the presenting sponsor of the US Open of Surfing. We've done amazing things with him because he understands what we're doing and we understand what he's doing. We did the first professional skateboard event last year in New York City. Again, both of us flew out there. We had a great time. I've had a great success being spokesman for other brands. In the history of our company, in the year 2000, we got picked out of about 650 companies. You guys can Google the history. Merrill Lynch decided that they wanted to feature a true entrepreneur in their campaign. So they sent out a memo. About 650 clients replied. They narrowed it down to about 30. And in a phone interview, they asked us, what makes you guys so special? So you make tacos. And we like, okay, true. My brother picks up the phone and he's talking to us, but where else in the world can a Chinese guy sell Mexican food? This is the American dream. And the guy goes, huh? He goes, look at the pictures. Because remember, everybody sent a little resume. So a month later, we get a phone call. 6 companies got picked out of the 650. Of the 6, we ended up with more than half of the entire ad budget. We knew that the ad budget was $110 million. Imagine with 13 stores, somebody puts in $60 million of advertising behind your company. Our bottom line almost quadrupled overnight. In any one point in the spring of 2000, I could go to an airport newsstand and almost every magazine had a full page picture of us in it, talking about Merrill Lynch. The opening night that the commercial aired was the first weekend in January of 2000. I'm in Palm Springs at a huge celebrity event. Somebody taps me on the shoulder right before dinner and said, hey, I just saw you on TV. I'm going, hey, what are you talking about? Our commercial had just started airing in the NFL playoff game. The president of Taco Bell, Peter Waller at the time, comes over and goes, I want to introduce myself. My name is Peter. Nice meeting you. I'm the president of Taco Bell. Nice meeting you. And he tells me, you just stole my line. I'm looking at it, goes, what are you talking about? He goes, I used to be able to tell people, only in America can a British guy sell Mexican food. I can't do that anymore because you just took the line. So I'm like, this is great. So I'm like, great, we get the campaign, we're the darling. About 7-8 years later, Visa uses the same ad agency, J. Walter Thompson. They called us. He goes, hey, how would you like to be in the campaign? I'm like, what are you talking about? Well, the campaign is Visa Takes Life, right? Whatever the campaign was, right? And they feature little clips of people doing different things. I remember a guy eating a hamburger about this big. I remember a kid running up to a tree and doing a flip. Those are the ones that I remember. This is, we'd like to have you guys in it. So my dad and my brother are in the commercial. It aired during the Italian Olympics. And my dad is literally in the kitchen making dumplings, doing exactly what he did in our commercial. So you got paid 10 grand and 10 grand again for doing the exact same thing. Didn't speak a word, just rolling dumplings. And my brother's walking behind him. It was awesome. Keep going forward. A couple of years later, Apple is doing a commercial. My son is moonlighting at the agency in Marina Del Rey where they're filming the commercial. And it used to be just a silhouette, right? You see the shadows and the guy is dancing and does the iPods, iTunes, and all that. So my son is not making a lot of money working in his day job. And somebody said, hey, you should audition for this part. And my son goes, no, I'm only here to be the lighting, gaffing, whatever it is that I need to do. No, you should audition because we know people that are picking the people. And there's hundreds of kids. Well, he gets picked. He doesn't say a thing to us. Got enough money to launch his company off of that commercial. And the commercial is, Nano takes videos. So when you see the Nano video, there's 5 or 6 kids dancing. One of them is a little Asian kid with a tie. That's my son. So now we have a 3-generation commercial. Me, my father, and my son. 3 different companies. These are world companies.
Where did he learn to dance like that?
A little bit from his dad, a little bit on his own. But anyway, and then a couple of years ago, Ford comes to me. So I got this idea. We're going to feature local businessmen that have Ford Transit around. I'm like, great. At the time we shot this commercial, and you guys have seen it, it just stopped airing this year, but it was airing for 2 years. They asked me, and I'm like, okay, do you realize that I'm part of the Toyota race team? If you see a big Toyota Tundra out there, that's my truck. And I'm like, yeah, but don't worry about it, Wayne. We're going to run it for a month, and that'll be, and we'll have somebody else do it. And I'm like, great. I don't mind doing it. And I call my Toyota guys, hey, it's a one-time thing, a month, and it'll be over, and I'm fine. I'm back on the team. He goes, no problem. They start airing it. Their response is off the chart because the brand, you know, is Southern California. They're like, not only do we like it, we're not going to shoot anybody else, and we would need to do a new one. I'm like, what do you mean, a new version? He goes, we don't want to just show you in the restaurant. We want to show you surfing and the whole lifestyle, how the car is not only good for business, but for pleasure. I'm like, okay. Come down to the beach. We went from a 30-second to a 60-second commercial. And that aired for the next 2 years, basically. And the Toyota people almost had a heart attack, but they're like, hey, you know what? there's nothing in our contract says you're exclusive, you know, have fun. So we've had a lot of fun. And then they said, well, we're not just going to use it for the commercials. We love to have it as the centerpiece of the LA Auto Show a year ago. And they basically took another car, wrapped it, paid for it, put it on display. And it was the one, because I had to go up there one day just to see if it was for real. And I stood there for about an hour. And everybody goes, oh my God, you're the guy in the commercial, you're the guy in the commercial, you're the guy in the commercial. I'm like, yeah, obviously this thing airs every day. A lot of fun stuff. Okay, that's my favorite shirt, the 5K. We took again another great event that's been going around. The marathon has not started yesterday. How do we make it better, right? So it used to be the finish line was, you know, the finish line. And you get a drink, you get a cracker or whatever, you get it and you go home. We said, okay, can we bring our taco truck and maybe feed some people? Can we create a beer garden? Can we do all this in order to keep the people there a little bit longer, right? And have a little bit more fun. So that the, because the 5K, the half marathon, the marathon, kind of everybody congregates, but they didn't have a village. So we're able to create a village and make the whole experience better for everybody. Okay, there I am with our guy. I get to blow the horn at the start of the race, and then I follow everybody after the race starts. Fun stuff. I mean, again, we looked at what they were doing. Okay, this is good, but let us take a stab at making this thing a little bit better. So we ended up becoming the title sponsor of the 5K race. Okay, there's the finish line. This didn't exist before we got in there. I mean, we brought the stage, we brought the bands, we brought all the little vendors around us. And obviously, I mean, if you look at the first year, that might have been one of those. So today you got one, two, the truck, four. It's, you know. So yes, a byproduct doing something really well, you get a lot more branding, a lot more visibility. It takes a little bit more work. But the ROI on something like this, huge. Because there, trust me, if you look at the actual sponsor list of the marathon, there are people that spent a lot more money, but they weren't nearly as resourceful as we were in bringing all the team together. Okay, this is crazy. I have nothing to do with racing, right? But a documentary was done almost 8 years ago. It was called Dust to Glory. So if you guys know anything about history of surf movies, the original one that everybody kind of sees because it plays on TV all the time, reruns, is The Endless Summer. It's the searching of the perfect wave. There's a sunset, two guys standing next to the sunset, right? They did a second one in 1994, was Endless Summer 2. And in the, I guess in the early 2000s, they did another sequel to that, which was called Step into Liquid, which was done by Bruce Brown's son, Dana Brown. And then somebody always thought we should do a documentary about the Baja 1000 race, which is the biggest off-road race in the world that we know anyway. So they do it. And again, Dana Brown, I'm the guy doing all the caterings, all the, because how do I make the event better? Have food at the end of the movie, right? Like anything else, hospitality. So I happen to be down there. A guy loans me a dune buggy to drive to the event. And imagine, 30,000 dune buggy. If you guys are all race fans, you would assume, why would else would Wing show up in a dune buggy if he wasn't a racer, right? So all of a sudden, I got everybody go, hey, Wing, are you going to be down at the Baja? I'm not talking about, what are you guys talking about? It's in Mexico. I have no desire to go down there. But one thing led to another. I get invited to go down there. So I show up, right? And in Sonata, the night before, they have this big party. Everybody's there. Bruce Brown's being honored for another, I guess, some cockamamie thing that he's being honored for, which is awesome because he is the original documentary filmmaker. And we started talking. All my friends, like, are you sure you have nothing to do with racing? I'm like, no, never raced a day in my life. How come you know everybody here? And remember, surfers know skaters, skaters know, it's a small community of enthusiasts. If you're into anything that's adrenaline driven, right? You kind of know somebody who does something else that does something else, right? So all of a sudden, the tire guys, the shock guys, everybody there that makes something to these trucks, I know them. And I'm like, great. Well, it's only natural that you should be involved. And I thought, okay, it'd be fun, you know? Don't get me wrong. But I thought, how much more fun would it be if we could add a little charity component to it? So we took an orphanage down there that needed some help in Ensenada. And I cahooted all my friends, said, okay, we'll do the team, but in order to be a part of our family and have fun, lots of coverage, lots of press, because I got all the magazine guys behind me, you got to help me out with the orphanage. They're like, that's it? I go, that's it. A few $1,000s. But a few $1,000s in Mexico is like hundreds of thousands here. So we got down there, we painted, we did all kinds of stuff for the orphanage. And along the way, we're able to have this great team, right? And this is, I mean, Jim Riley, who was one of the drivers, he's now started his own tequila company, but he used to be the head marketing guy for a Kettle One. Dave Threshy Jr. here, his family is still in the Orange County Register. I mean, and I can go on about some other really fun people on the team, but I was able to really kind of pull in some really fun people to do this. And this is one of the trucks that we had. So we got, you know, the Wahoo's truck. I mean, it's kind of a fun little thing. And this is just one of like about five or six different trucks we sponsored over the years. A lot of fun. Again, synergy, getting the right people together. And the common thing that held us all together was the fact that we're all friends in California. And this truck came in second at the race. It was awesome. I mean, we had a lot of fun. So, you know, again, you know, and for the women, this is the greatest thing that ever happened. The first year that I got involved, there was a TV show, and I believe he was the number two guy on, what is it called, People Magazine's Hottest 50 Guys. And the number two guy, I think, for 2 years running was a guy named Patrick Dempsey. Right? Grey's Anatomy. Yes. It was at the height of his career. His other hobby is racing. So the night before the first Baja 1000 race that I was a part of, we're having dinner. There's about 50 guys. And sitting next to my left was Patrick Dempsey, because his sponsor, my sponsor, were the same. And we, anyway, it's a long story. The greatest thing was just being able to hang out with this guy. And I'm laughing. I'm telling all the women at home, goes, you're not going to believe who I'm having dinner with. And they're like, yeah, you're full of it. And I'm like, here's pictures. Boom, boom, boom. It was awesome. Got a lot of good brownie points out of that one. Okay, snowboarding, right? So we talk about surfing, skating. This is me. This is basically my silly outfit every winter. I stand on top of the slope style course, which is otherwise known as the obstacle course. I'm the starter, I'm a volunteer. This coming March will be my 20th consecutive national championships. So not only do I talk, I do work. I'm a volunteer, and this is the former mayor, Katrina Foley. She's also a former executive director. So Sean White, so we get to this little kid. The first skateboard that this kid ever got came from me when he was 6 years old. I've done, I don't know how many hundreds of events with Sean White. And back then, the whole thing was, we got to get to the Olympics. Whatever, right? So this, when we did our first plastic gift card, that's him. This is actually a gift card. So again, these are little fun things, you know, I'm involved in, and we have a lot of fun doing it. Obviously, you know, the biggest radio station on the planet, K-Rock, I mean, we've done all kinds of fun things. We're still, I'm the original MC of the Orange County Music Awards. This is ongoing now, I think it's 14th year now. And again, great bands, you know, they need my help when they can't afford to buy it. I'm their filet mignon, remember, when they can't afford it. I'm there backstage when they can't afford anything. When they become bigger, that's where I come in. So one of the bands that has done fairly well for them is the Dirty Heads. They just released their second album, Cabin by the Sea, whatever, and it's iTunes top five on the alternative chart. And when we were doing this thing last year, they were filming, and the part of the video was Spread Too Thin, was the name of the song, was their hit from last summer. The storyline behind it was every band member would get fired from their job, and then they would get back together and go play music again. So Duddy, Justin, his job was he was gonna work inside a food truck. So guess who gets to be a part of that? Okay, there we are. So this is, trust me, he was making ice cream, hot dog, whatever we were, this is the inside of our taco truck. So in the video, when you see it, I get to fire Duddy in the video. So I have a couple of lines that you can't read because the song is playing over my head, and it was awesome. So the guy sitting down there is Jason. He's the head marketing guy for Vizio. So we did a bunch of really cool things with them because their song, the album release party, we did it at South by Southwest. We did some really cool collaboration together. And as part of the payment, I would drop off 70 or 60, whatever at the time was their biggest TV. I had five of them in the back of my truck and I delivered to the band members. It was like Christmas like you've never seen before. But again, these are really fun things. And again, collaborations, like, you know, album release party, this is even better. We talked about being marketing, collaboration, all this. Okay, so without naming names, because I might get in trouble, because, you know, I don't want K-Rock to, you know, get upset at me, is K-Rock wanted to charge somebody a lot of money for the opportunity to be tied in to the Dirty Heads. The Dirty Heads happened to be their house band, their local Huntington Beach guys. So they were going to charge somebody $50,000 to have this party. The Dirty Heads goes, we really like what you're going to give us, K-Rock, but one, we don't get any of the money. It's all advertising dollars. So the sales guys and marketing guys make all the money at K-Rock, but the band members would get nothing. So they said, okay, we really like this, but we really like to do something as a thank you to Wahoos because they've been with us since we kind of got the ball rolling. So they came back to me and said, okay, wait, if you can get us a stage, we will do the party. And K-Rock said, okay, how do we participate? Well, we will let you do the meet and greet afterwards. So we do the Doheny Blues Festival down at Doheny Beach every year. The state park needed new bathrooms. I said, okay, we can sell food this day and raise enough money to pay for your bathrooms because they needed $7,000, not 50. I'm like, done. So we'll call our friends at Monster because they also sponsored a band and they have these trailers. They can be for anything, stages, anything you need. So we called everybody we needed. So we gotta take care of the state park. We have a beach to do it on because they wanted to do the concert on the beach. Without doing any work, just a little word of mouth, we had over 2,000 people show up. All the fans, because it was their new album release party. More important was, again, not having to pay K-Rock the seven, they still ended up showing up. And we told them, give away all the tickets you want because the only way you can give away meet and greets is by doing radio commercials that you are going to charge somebody a lot of money. But now you don't have a choice because if you want to have the opportunity, you got to promote yourself. So we got tagged because they said, hey, come to meet the Dirty Heads. And this is us running the whole show. Okay, we'll go back to Angel Stadium now. This is fun. This event is going to take place next Thursday again. Okay, so remember when we had everybody standing? Now this is gonna get even crazier. How many people have ever dropped in to Angel Stadium in a helicopter? Okay, I didn't think so. There I am. The sheriff's department met me outside the stadium. We went around and I was the guest of honor for this event. There are 20,000 third graders. It's called the Gift of History. It's a basic field trip for the kids, and they get to learn about the history of Orange County, right? Why the streets are named what they are, what businesses start in Orange County, whatever. The main guy, while they're doing all this, is none other than Mickey Mouse. So when they asked me, how would you like to take a helicopter ride, drop into Angel Stadium, and get greeted by Mickey Mouse? I'm like, okay, what's the joke here, right? Like, who's pulling my leg? So it turns out, right, again, having the right friends in the right places, one of my really good friends happens to be in charge of this event. The honest truth is, a week before the event was gonna take place, the real person that was supposed to drop in had to cancel. Last minute emergency meeting up on the Hill. Governor Brown was the real guy. So I was on a very short list. At least I made the list. So I got asked. So this year I'm in charge of greeting the guy who drops in the helicopter next Thursday, which will be another kid that I met. So it'll be a lot of fun. Now, this is the crazy stuff. So we go back to, if you guys are car enthusiasts, this is the biggest car auction in the world, the Bear Jackson, right? It used to be only in Arizona, now they travel. I think there's one in Vegas. And for about 3 years, there was one in Orange County. So in my little pea brain, that I had, because I'm always thinking, right? Remember the picture earlier, little Kelly Smith right here, right? Kelly had started another nonprofit called the Center for Living Peace across from UCI. So I thought it'd be really cool if I could help her, because her ex-husband happened to be a really good friend of mine, a guy named Vinny Smith. You guys know the company called Quest Software that just sold for about $1.52 billion, whatever they did. That's her ex-husband. Anyway, so when you have a lot of money, it's easy to start nonprofits. So we started talking. How can we get some more exposure for the center? Like, what is it that you need? Because you don't really need money, you need exposure. So I had this crazy idea that I thought, okay, if I can get maybe a celebrity, right? Mr. Tony Hawk, who's right behind me, involved, I could maybe kind of get a little notoriety for this deal, right? So at an event, you gotta pay to play, I call it, in the charity world. So in a nutshell, this is a customized Tony Hawk Mustang worth about $75,000. So we got this at one of the events. Because guess what happens, right? When you buy the car, right? And I literally drove it from LA to Orange County and put it in storage. I drove it 35 miles, that's all I had to drive it, in about a couple of miles during that day. And I told Kelly, I goes, I got this idea that if we get the car to your auction, I'm gonna basically re-gift it to you, then I get the write-off, we get to do some really fun stuff, maybe I'll get Tony to show up to your event, and we will sell more tickets, raise some more money. In the midst of doing this, I get a phone call from the Orange County Register, who is the media partner to the auction. And they're sitting there going, Wayne, do you realize that they will allow a couple of charity cars into the auction free of charge? I'm like, you're kidding. What's the catch? You have to get a celebrity involved. Let me think about it. I'm trying to get a celebrity for the center. They need a, so I'd say, okay, tell them what I got. So Leilani calls the Bear Jackson people and say, hey, we have the Tony Hawk Mustang. And they first question, can you get Tony to show up? So now my pea brain is working again. So I'm like, okay, what is it gonna take to get Tony to show up? Because I know where he's gonna be, he's halfway around the country. I gotta share the proceeds. I go, Kelly, if I would have given you a car straight up, you would have gotten, let's say, 50,000 bucks, right? If you can share the proceeds with the Tony Hawk Foundation, you're gonna get 100 times more exposure than if we just did it at your facility. We're gonna get media play, video, print, everything that goes with it. And we get to go on stage. Kelly didn't think twice, because the money wasn't as important as the exposure to what she was doing. So then I called Tony, he goes, hey Tony, you get to double dip. I already paid you once for the car, I'm gonna give you another 50%. All you gotta do is have you show up. Because I kinda knew the figure, roughly 25,000 his guest appearance fee. And he's never charged me to do anything, but I knew that that would say, okay, because people on his team will go, done, because we get the money again. So off we went. So we sell the car, got all the exposure. Now, in the other world that I've loved doing is, this is our grand opening in Vegas. I could never really water ski a whole lot, love to wakeboard. So we built a fun little wakeboarding. This is an above the ground pool in the parking lot of our store in Vegas. So it's about this deep. There's one pool, a rail, and another pool to land in. And what they're holding on to is a winch that's tied to a truck on that side. Then when the guy goes go, the winch starts, and it's just like a cable, you go across. So we had two guys that are basically world champions doing this thing. You talk about a fun party, right? Again, using your resources, here's the two guys. World champions. It was unbelievable. It's about 100 degrees in Vegas. And just the whole idea of bringing the beach to Vegas. Okay? Again, these are just fun, silly things that I get to do because of the resources you have. Okay. This is even better. So you guys have all seen the little crazy guy that sits on the floor of the Lakers game, the guy in the crazy outfit next to Jack, right? That's Mr. Adler. He's a huge music producer. Cisco Adler is this white guy right here. Schwazy is the black guy. Together they're called Schwazy. They're rappers, and they have one famous song called the Corona song, right? So as you can see again, we opened a new store in Austin, Texas, which is called Texas Ski Ranch. It's a wakeboarding ranch, right? And I asked these guys, hey, would you guys come out? We had about 5,000 kids out there. Great. So good friends, they're like, we'd love to do this for you. Then last year, flying out every year, we go by South by Southwest, the biggest music interactive trade show in the world. Thousands of people, thousands of bands come out, and we're out there. So we happen to be on the same Southwest flight out of LAX. In first class, well, actually it wasn't Southwest, it was somebody else because there's a first class cabin, was Snoop Dogg. And we're like, cool, Snoop Dogg's on our flight, right? So we get to the other end, and first question goes, hey, Shwezi, do you have a ride into town? Because the airport's about 20 minutes from downtown. So Cisco goes, no, I don't have a ride. He goes, our truck's coming to pick us up. We'll give you a ride. Where are you staying? To W, perfect. We're staying at the Hilton. I'll see you later. Next question is, what show are you guys playing tonight? Because every year he plays a little show middle of the night, and we usually go hang out with them. He's like, we're not. I'm like, you're not playing this year? He goes, no, Shwezi's not here, so I'm only going to spin records. Well, who are you DJing for? I'm DJing for Snoop Dogg. I'm like, awesome. He goes, what are the chances that we can come and hang out with you? Not that we want to hang out with him. We're going to see Snoop Dogg. He goes, well, let me know. So I'm like, how many people? I'm like, I'm not sure. Let me go into town. Remember the Vizio photo earlier? We were doing the Dirty Heads release party that weekend. I called Jason. He goes, Jason, how many are on your team? He goes, there's three of us, right? Three marketing guys. Me and my wife and the two people from my store. Seven of us. This party is private. People pay hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars to host this party. It was actually Doritos, their large chip release party. They paid a couple million bucks to have this thing. Private, invitation only, can't get in. I call Cisco back. I said, Cisco, I'd like to come, but there's going to be seven of us. He goes, no problem. Just tell when you get to the door, you're with me. Sure enough, the Vizio guy's going, we're not going to get in. He goes, hey, Cisco said, all you got to do is tell him we're with him. We get to the front of the dark, there's no list, there's nothing. We're with Cisco, come on in. We end up, seven of us, on the DJ booth watching Snoop Dogg. Fun night. Kind of being on the field in a different level. Okay, to end this little thing, this is my lovely wife. So, Sean White, besides being a phenomenal snowboarder, he's the only athlete who has won both summer and winter X Games. He's won a couple of summer half pipe events and a bunch of winter snowboard events. So this is, happens to be in Vegas. This is the back of the Wynn, I believe. And that's Nikki and our other friends. It's just really fun day, you know. And now I'm getting ready because one of my other really good friends is going to be in charge of the snowboard venue in Moscow or wherever it is in Russia. So there might be a chance we may make it out there, may not, you know. But I mean, just really fun stuff, you know, in my life. But it comes back to, if I wasn't crazy or stupid enough to ask the surfers, how do I make your event better, right? Now, if you start thinking about everything that came in 25 years, it's what I call the mutual admiration society. Every athlete aspires to be a musician, right? And every musician aspires to be an athlete. And there's this thing going around where baseball players love football players love hockey. It's crazy. I just happen to be in a place where I'm usually the only guy in the casual category. Next weekend, I'll be going to an event with Emeril Lagasse. There's lots of guys at that end. Tonight, or actually tomorrow night, there's a huge event at Disney with another winemaker. There's no shortage of guys that do that. But in my space, I'm the only guy crazy enough or stupid enough to do that. And I've been able to surround myself with some really fun people. So this is the latest one. Somehow, we do sell beer and wine in our restaurant, but we're never really that good at it, right? So this is actually November 2012. This is a year ago, right? This is kind of like the Bible, right? So there's three guys on here. There's a Bettina, a Carter, and a Bevan Sellers. Right, they're talking about the next great Cabernet guys, right? So Russell, we meet. So I always got to carry one of these when I go to restaurants, right? So it's all about collaboration. So on this thing here, it's got the Bevan Sellers. He made three barrels of a Sauvignon Blanc. On here says Wahoo's Fish Taco. On the back has the Wahoo's Fish Taco 25th anniversary. 25 cases were made. Imagine how much money you would have to pay, if you know anything about wines, to get somebody to do something for you. Before you even get to this part, you got to pay the winemaker thousands just to use their name. Right? So this is one of the best. The stuff he makes is unbelievable. Okay? So I might have to leave this behind for somebody who likes a good Sauvignon Blanc. Now, here's another crazy guy. This is the guy who's going to be having dinner tomorrow night at Disney. Okay? Williams Selyem. They're not known for this. They're known for their Pinots. Earlier this year in Houston, the big hoedown, big charity event, okay? He's known as the godfather of Pinot up in Northern California. There's 2,300 bottles out there. He wins the best in show out of the whole group. Brings out a 9-liter bottle, etched on, says best in show. They auction it off at the end of the event. $205,000. These are the guys, right? So everything that I happen to be is, if you become the man in whatever it is, or women in whatever it is that you do, you're accidentally going to be bumping into people in other areas that are the best in what they do. Because nobody wants to hang out with the number two guy. Everybody wants to hang out with the number one guy. So I literally met this guy almost a year ago to the date, right? And the joke was, he was the honoree at last year's Emerald Agassi event where they raised over $2 million. I saw him and somebody told me, that's the guy you need to meet. 5 minutes later, I get a tap on my shoulder from Bob. Bob Cabral is his name. He goes, Wing, my name is Bob. Somebody told me I need to meet you. Because I was with the honoree from the year before. I couldn't find a picture of the honoree from the year before. So the cover of 2011, when the Wine Spectator does their top 100 wines of the world, 100 of the world, the guys that were on the cover was the guys from Kosta Browne. They've also become really good friends of ours. So they were the honoree 2 years ago. I happened to be with them. So it was only natural that the new honoree said, you need to meet. It was hilarious. So I shouldn't be with these people, because it doesn't make sense. But if you go back to, how did I become the guy for the winemakers? How do I make their lives better? I'm not a chef. But guess what they want to do, and all of you guys do, that I learned a long time ago. We will do anything to impress our kids. Right? So I took care of the kids when I started. The kids are now 30, 40 years old, right? And I've never changed. Because to all of the winemakers' kids, they don't know who Emerald is. They know who Ryan Sheckler is. It's hilarious. It hasn't changed. The formula hasn't changed, right? I mean, do you guys know? I mean, at the height, now she's kind of like rebranding herself, right? Miley Cyrus. Does anybody have any idea? Did anybody have kids that wanted to go when she was the Hannah Montana tour? No. Let me throw you some numbers, and I don't know if you guys know this. This is the behind the scenes, right? Henry and Susan Samueli own the Honda Center, the Ducks and the whole deal, right? They also own Broadcom. They're billionaires. When the Hannah Montana show was going to take place at the Honda Center, this is almost, I think, 4 years ago at her height. She had just gotten off the TV show. Okay, a suite at the Honda Center for a hockey game is about $2,200, give or take, depending where you are. You throw some food in there, $3,000, give or take. Okay, at any concert, a ticket in a suite, additional, will probably be about $200 to $300, give or take. For the Hannah Montana show, $32,000.
For the box?
For the box. And the Samuelis couldn't buy any of them back. Nobody wanted to sell it. The season holder, I'm coming to you, goes, you're not going to be here that night? I'll pay you $32,000 for your suite. Who wanted to come? All the government people, all the Anaheim PD, firemen, anybody that say, hey, I've kind of kept you out of trouble all this time. You know, I'm here at making sure that everything is going very smooth. I just need one little thing, just one little favor. My daughter liked to come to that show, and I don't want to sit up in the nosebleed. Think about it. Has that changed? No, because I've gone through the Backstreet Boys, NSYNC, Spice. I've seen the whole thing. It's never changed. The things that people will do for their kids is crazy. Right? I mean, Jingle Ball tickets right now. One of my employees asked me, he goes, I really like to go. I'm like, okay, $35 gets you behind the stage. You see the back of their heads. You can't take your 12-year-old to that, can you? No. Well, if you're in the nosebleed, you're at 65. If you're parallel to the stage, you're 90. If you can actually see the stage, you're at 150. If you can actually breathe the air, it's 300. And if you want to be in the first five rows, 400. She's like, oh my God. I'm like, exactly. And the thing's already sold out. It doesn't matter. Because there's enough people out there that want to take care of their kids. Right? So I laugh about it, but it's not going to change. I don't care how old your son or daughter is. We will make sure that they get into the best universities, they get the best this, the best that. Because that's what we are as parents. So as a brand, think about it. How do you make your client or their kids or their friends, whatever? Because if you're that guy that can make anybody's lives better, word will get out and you're going to get referral after referral after referral. And the easiest way to get new customers, referral, right? There's always one attorney that takes care of this particular part of the industry because he figured out if I can take care of this, all of the people in that space are going to come to me because I'm the guy. It's never changed. In every industry, there's one go-to guy. In the alternative sports, adrenaline, whatever field, I'm that guy. I'm there on the mountains. I'm there at the lakes. I'm there on the rivers. Wherever it's happening, I'm going to be there. People laugh. They're like, why do you still come out after 25 years? Because by being there, it reinforces I'm still here and nobody else come after my space. It's protecting and I get more referrals. It's just what happens. The moment you send in your second lieutenant, you won't get the referral. The job will still get done, but the referral stops. People feel obligated to support me when I'm there. I'm taking a Sunday out of my week to take care of a bunch of 12-year-olds. Who does that, right? So unless your kid is in Little League, you're not going to that game. Nobody's paying you enough to do it. So when you start thinking about it, right, it's not that hard. So that's what I do. I mean, the brand, what does it stand for? Making people's lives better. Anything that I do, trust me, I went to the first hockey game at the old Forum with an old coworker of mine. Remember when you walked in, you could either go down or up. We went in and we went up, about halfway up. And I sat there going, this is really weird. Because in the old days, right, there's no speakers, you couldn't hear a thing. I'm like, this is the most boring thing I've ever been to my whole life. And I'm watching the Kings and I can't hear a thing. Every now and then a goal is scored and I hear some cheers.
And they're this big.
Yes, and you can't hear a thing. All of a sudden, towards the end of the game, we start coming down because we're going to leave. And I'm like, hey, I can actually hear the shh, shh. I'm like, then I say, hey, there's some empty seats down there. So let's walk a little farther. And now I can actually hear shh, shh. And I can hear the people hitting the glass. I'm like, wow, that's exciting. But from where we were, it was like watching TV with this volume off. Right? So I'm like, you know what? Love you to death, Lo. You and I are former co-workers from a different life. But the next time we go to a game, let me get the tickets. Because I can't do this. This is boring. You know? So I've now skated at Staples, right? I'm friends with Luke Rubatai, the president of the Kings. You know, I've been to their game seven. I've been to the game seven with the Ducks. And I have nothing to do with hockey. But that little thing told me, I go, God, you know, if somebody's ever a fan, and they want to go to a game, let me take you to a game and see what it feels like to actually touch the glass and hear the guy slamming into the glass. That's an experience. Being up in the 400, I'm like, what the hell's going on down here? I have no idea. I can't hear a thing. Today, at least they have speakers, so you can kind of hear it. But back at the old forum, you couldn't hear a thing, right? So think about anything you do in your lives. I'm sure we've all set where you can actually touch, right? When they literally do this, that's because we've got to raise the roof because we're right there, right? I've been there. And that, the grass over at Verizon, it's so far to the stage. And if you drink a little too much, you feel like you're going to roll down the hill. It's so steep, right? So trust me, I've been in the cheap seats. And I will tell you, hands down, being up there and being on stage, the experience is so much better when you're on stage. And even better when there's free food and beverage. Trust me, right? Those beers at the stadiums are so expensive, right? So think about all that. How, why was my motivating? Yes, I can make a little bit of money if I'm the right guy, being able to do okay. But it's not rocket science, right? I give you guys the secret. Think about all the most successful guys in any field that they're in. What is it that they do? Are they that much smarter than you? No, they're not. They figure it out, they anticipate, boom, and they deliver. And that's why nobody's like going away from them. You're like, but I'm so much cheaper. But price is not an issue. It's the service that you provide, the experience. And my life is so much better when I'm doing business with you, right? So you guys need to be that. I don't care how old or young you are, right? There's always somebody in our group that we know that when we need something, right? So my life is this wonderful Rolodex. I have people in everywhere. Now I used to go to Napa and I used to go to wine, and now I don't go to that anymore. I call ahead. We only do private tasting because sitting there and paying $25 for 4 little ounces, whatever it is that you get, and then you get rushed out of there, is so not as nice as when you can sit there for 4 hours and drink 10 bottles and not be charged a dime. I'm going to tell you, it's so much better than the 4 glasses and you get to get out of there, right? And I get to tell about it and I get to invite friends to do it. So the games, all this, it's because I now have this crazy service that I'm able to support it. So you guys can do that. You don't have to do food. You can do whatever it is because I have attorney friends that are the best, whatever it is. I have accountant. They're the reason we all hang out, because they are the best at what they do. So I made my life mission to surround myself with lots and lots of people. So if I can share that with you guys, I came here, you know, hopefully you guys will get some fun stuff out of this. I'll open it up for some questions. I mean, there's really no mystery. I'm not that much smarter than the rest of you guys.
Wayne, thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm going to start with a few questions from
sure.
the virtual audience, and I'll give our in-person audience a chance to gather their thoughts. First question, lots of entrepreneurs you see entrepreneurs who tend to be serial entrepreneurs, and I think that might be because they love the thrill and the challenge
yes.
of starting something new. What has kept you passionate and motivated about your business now that it's successful and established?
Well, the big thing for me is I look at myself, because somebody always asked me that a question very similar to that, like, what's your exit strategy? And then this year, I got to meet a couple of guys that are in their 60s in rock bands, and I looked at them going, why would they want to do anything else? Does Mick Jagger look like he's not having any fun? Right? So I've gotten to hang out with some of these guys, and I'm like, are you crazy? You get lucky once in a blue moon. Like, when I talk to all my friends that are retired, and I have lots of guys that have won things and retired, if there's one thing they miss, is playing. But sports age kind of, right? Musician, you can play as long as people are willing to buy your tickets. So as long as people are willing to buy my food, I'm like, do I really want to do anything else? I enjoy people saying, I love Wahoos, just like I love the Rolling Stones. So you get lucky once in a blue moon, hang on to it, because when you get out, just like all the players, it's like, dude, there's somebody else new. So I love what I do. So, that's the reason I stay doing what I do. I'm not a serial guy. I've dibbled and dabbled in my early days, never made any money other than what I'm doing today, because I'm good at what I do.
In your opinion, what are 2 or 3 of the most common fatal flaws you see new businesses make that cause them to fail?
The main one is, again, while you guys are here getting a degree, is understanding the passion, because passion is what got you to jump, right, to get started, but not understanding the business side of it. And the business side, the biggest one is cash flow. So that's like the number one. It's no, like in my category, no restaurants fail because they have bad food. They fail because they don't understand how to run a business. And that's ultimately, now, like in any business, finance is the cornerstone of the business. You got to understand cash flow.
A learner's curious as to how you approach product development from idea generation to that point that a new item appears on the menu. And what about this process could people in other industries benefit from?
Basically, listen to your customers. I mean, people that have been eating the same thing over and over again, they say, hey, have you ever thought of doing this to it, right? Like brown rice. People love rice, but they're like, God, brown rice is so much healthier. Even though you hate eating brown rice, the idea of it is really cool. Well, eventually we said, okay, let's just give it a spin. Today, almost half of the rice we sell is brown rice because people understand the health benefits. So listen to your customer that's been eating. I got a great phone call the other day for somebody who said, hey, almost everything I've always asked for, given enough time you guys have done, I have one last request. I see that you're doing the Alzheimer's Association poster. You talk about the omega-3, blah, blah, blah. And where's the salmon? I'm like, you know what? We've been working on it for a year. We had to find a wild caught salmon supplier that was big enough to supply our entire chain. We finally found one in Alaska, blah, blah, blah. It's coming in November. He goes, that's it. So listen to your customers.
Hi, my name is Brett. I'm a learner in the MBA program here in PM 86901. So I can get my credit. But my question was, as you're business became successful and you started to look to expand, was there one thing that kind of caught you by surprise, like, oh man, I didn't even think about that? But you have to obviously, like you said, for the business side, take care of it.
I tell people is it's your ability to adjust and adapt, because if you knew everything right, you wouldn't be doing what you do. So at every growth, at every stage, there's every milestone. There was like, oh my God, what are we gonna do? Because there's four of us, three brothers and Steve. What happens when we open the fifth store, right? That's the first hurdle. Because there's one store now that we gotta rotate in and out of, right? So there's different things. And again, mentors, talk to people, resources, and ask questions. Don't be afraid to go, hey, what happens when you do this? What happens if you did this, right? Like we tried doing our own delivery for a while, believe me. I was one of the truck drivers because I'm one of the three guys in the company that knew how to drive a big truck. And you know, you're unloading 10,000 pounds of rice and beans and fish. You're like, is this the best way to use mine, right? And eventually, I think somebody crashed one of the trucks. I'm like, okay, that's the bad idea. But I like say, for me, is it the best use of my resources to go do caterings? As long as I'm there, almost hands down, I'll get two or three referrals out of it. So it may appear to go, why are you, you know, because people ask, well, you've done this thing for 25 years, why are you schlepping rice and beans? Because all I need to do is have that one CEO from another company. One other guy goes, dude, this is awesome. Love for you to do it for us. So that's part of one of the reasons. I think it's manual labor at its core. But getting the re-interface, having customers say, oh my God, there's the owner serving me a taco. You don't do that at In-N-Out or anywhere else in Southern California. So there's a lot of things that sometimes I'll say, bad idea, but I get the reaction that goes, that emphasizes, again, reinforces what I need to do.
A learner asks, or thanks you for sharing all these different promotions that work very well for your brand. And she wonders, have you ever had an experience where a promotion, you know, actually did some damage to your brand? And she's curious what you do to repair it. What do you think about damage control and repairing damage to a brand?
Yeah, well, there are some instances, for instance, and I'm trying to remember, there's been a few. It's happened more than once in terms of NYE, New Year's Eve parties at the Orange County Fairgrounds. For some reason, it won't rain on New Year's Day, because I think the Rose Bowl has a deal with God, but it'll rain the night before, right? So you're trying to promote this thing that's outdoors, whatever. In New York, it'd be snowing, raining, people are out there. Nobody's like, well, what happens in New York? People are there. So they thought it'd be a great idea to do it here. So we try to sponsor because we knew a lot of the bands, and it'd be a really fun idea until it rains. So we had instances where people thought, oh my God, I didn't get to go, and you know, I spent $50, I had a lousy time, you owe me $50. I'm like, I'm just one of the sponsors, right? So you gotta be careful with what's your backup. And the one that almost kind of went sideways was just recently, about a month ago, we had the Wet Electric Party at the beach in Huntington Beach. You guys heard about all that?
Yes.
We were the main guy too. And half of the office said, bad idea. The other half said, let's just go. What could go wrong? Well, everything that could go wrong went wrong. Right? The weather sucked. They lost the alcohol permit the day before. Everything that could go wrong went wrong. But guess what? I'm used to it. I'm used to that whatever can go wrong will go wrong. We went down there. We did what we could. We did as much damage control as we could on site. We got zero phone call from anybody asking for their money back as compared to before, because this time we were prepared for it. You know, so these are the things you learned. I mean, you can't control everything. And the one thing I tell people today, try as much as you can to go back to the referral. If somebody tells you, I love to do business with you and this is who I've done business with, call those people. Today we don't do any business. And the reason we did Wet Electric, because the company that was putting it on, we have a good relationship with. Even with everything that went down, we knew it wasn't their fault. It was all the things that were out of their control. So we stood behind them. So today, I don't work with anybody who I don't know. Because the last thing they'll do is they'll like, it's Wahoo's fault. I don't need that.
Wayne, thank you so very much for coming. It was great listening to you. I'm a mentor here. My name is Chuck. Question for you on goods and services versus just services from a, like, let's say, a consulting perspective. Mm-hmm. Food product is a little bit more tangible. Pricing is tangible. You have a, you know, if I'm going in there to spend a dollar, I know what I'm getting for my dollar. Mm-hmm. Services, kind of what is your idea on that from a startup perspective? For how you handle services, consulting services to a particular group, let's say doctors. I mean, that's something that I'm working on right now, so just kind of wanted to get your idea on that.
With anything, right? Try, and like I said, when you look at the old marketing, was a product life cycle, pricing is the last thing you want to compete with, right? Talk about, like I said, what is it, the intangibles that you do, whatever it is that you do. And don't try to, because the comparison thing doesn't work either, because if you do that, somebody's going to compare you to somebody else later, right? So just figure out what is it that you stand for, what is it that you're good at, and just say, here. And if you can do that, as crazy as it sounds, it eventually people will say, okay, you know what? Because they say, I can't get a job until you have experience. And you can't get experience until you get a job. Well,
catch 22.
Yeah. And you just got to keep hammering, because give me the opportunity to show you that I can do this. And then you'll be, you know, pleasantly surprised that I am the best at what I say I do. So, you know, I tell all the students, fake it until you make it. Because nobody's going to give you that opportunity just because, right? Nobody's crazy enough, because they don't want to look back to their bosses as well. So you just got to go in there full of confidence that you have the best service, tangible, whatever it is that you do. And hopefully you're right.
Well, Wing, it was nice to see you today, and thanks for sharing your day with us.
Thank you.
My name is Steve Holliday, Management 87540, and my question is, what techniques do you use to forecast your business plans, so that you can continue to provide the personal service that you render, not only to your customers, but to your charitable activities, to your clients, associates, and so forth? Because I agree 100%, there's no substitute for personal service, ethical service, competent service, and providing tangible results in whatever area those results pertain to, sooner rather than later, and on time or sooner too. And that keeps people happy, and you avoid the legal problems as well by keeping people happy. So I'm looking forward to your answer, thanks.
Okay, the thing is, like the word is anticipate, right? That's really the key. And if you listen, right? Like, I don't know the first thing about what the next hottest skateboarder will be, any more than the hottest new surfer. But having friends at Billabong, Quicksilver, all the guys that the kids aspire to have sponsor them, keeps my right on the pulse. So having the resource, anything that you want to know about anything, I don't know the first thing about music. But I happen to have a few guys that know a lot about music, right? So the resource thing is really good, because you, as we get older, we only know what we know. And trust me, the last thing that you and I know is what's hip. That's just first thing. It's just flat out.
And we're always learning.
Yes. So, exactly. So I ask my son all the time, but my son is now 26. What's hot to a 14-year-old, my son may be a little bit out of touch. So I go to my 14-year-olds. What are you guys listening to? What's relevant to you today? So whatever it is that I'm trying to do, I ask what's relevant to you. So if I'm trying to go after a 12-year-old, I don't ask a 30-year-old what I need to do. I ask a 12-year-old.
Wing, appreciate your time. Curious, how do you share, or in what ways do you encourage your passion with your employees throughout your different chains?
How do I encourage it is by, again, listening to them, what motivates them, right? I have probably about 95% Hispanics, right? Taking them to a hockey game, whoop-de-doo, right? Taking them to a soccer galaxy game, a little more exciting. It's just understanding what motivates them, right? So I'm always there for them. Anything that I get, I share with them, but I want to do it in a way that they're excited about it. Don't give them skate shoes if they want running shoes, is what I tell people, right? So always kind of listen to everybody that's around you.
Hi, Wing. Thank you again for your time. And my name is Jovan. I'm one of the academic advisors here, also part of the MBA program. So I do have a question. Sure. You mentioned earlier that you have some locations, and you have a location in New York, I believe, mm-hmm. Nevada, obviously here in Southern California. Sure. How do you, like, what kind of strategies do you use to determine how to expand there? I mean, New York's pretty significant. It's completely opposite than over here, obviously. So what contributes to your strategies when you're identifying a location?
In the early days versus today is, early days, customers say, hey, I'm tired of driving from here to here. Can you open a store here? Literally, that's how we expanded in the beginning, because we didn't have time to go actually scout any location. Say, hey, somebody's tired of driving from Yorba Linda to Costa Mesa. We'll go out, look around Yorba Linda and see. Today, we literally have people that travel to California on their vacations, work, whatever it is that they do. They're like, this is really cool. How can we have this at home? So we'll find a franchisee in New York. They have the Five Guy franchises in New York and other businesses. So that's how we got it. Nebraska was a kid that went to school in Colorado, graduating his mom and dad. We don't know what we want to do, but this is one thing we think we want to do. So they came visit us in California. That's why we're in Nebraska. The one that we didn't talk about is we have a store now in Tokyo, opened in August. So if you go down to Lido Island by the cannery, and across there's the Blue Water Grill. If you keep walking on that wooden pier, there's Buddha's favorite, the little sushi place. He's a surfer. So he came to me and goes, I go back to Japan every month anyway. Might as well do a business in Japan. So he's our franchisee in Japan, Tokyo. That's how it all, really. I mean, we're getting ready to open Arizona next. Arizona, new state, Long Island, new state, and hopefully Philadelphia. And these are, again, friends that love to visit you in California. Can I have one of those at home?
Hi, Jim Zanthakis here. How are you today?
Good, Jim.
Good. Listen, you grew up during the infancy of social media.
Yes.
For some insights, probably benefited you dramatically. How would you suggest that somebody starting a business take that first step at getting involved and incorporating their, you know, social media endeavors?
Okay. We were doing social media before we knew it was social media, right? Then they called it word of mouth. Social media is word of mouth on steroids. So it helps your business, and it can sink your business that quickly. The old days took a little longer for them to sink your business. So the whole idea is find brand ambassadors, people that believe in what you do. Hopefully they have some friends that have big, you know, lines. Because the whole thing is about having downlines, right? People that actually listen to you. So the more of those people you have, whether you call it cloud score, Facebook likes, whatever you want to call it, there's different names for everything, right? Depending on what platform you're using, embrace it. It can literally take you from zero to hero just like that. Because you look at how the whole truck food thing started, right? The Kogi guy basically says, hey, I'm gonna be here, boom. He was the first guy to use Twitter to help him. So there's different ways you can use it, but you gotta embrace it, you gotta know what you're doing, and have people, kids mainly, show you how to really maximize it, how to engage and how to talk the talk. Because you and I don't know how to talk the talk.
Yeah, my children told me I don't.
Exactly.
Okay, I think we have time for two more questions.
Thank you for sharing your time and knowledge today.
Sure.
My name is John. I'm a learner here. How do you protect the quality of your image, not only by food, but at these events, because they can be logistical nightmares? How do you make sure that doesn't get lost?
Well, there's only so many people. On the restaurant side, we have a corporate training team that goes back and retrains and rechecks. We have secret shopper. We have all the things for the store level that constantly monitors service, cleanliness, everything. Okay, so that's one thing. The second part is on the outside events, there's only, again, a small group of us, the catering team that goes out. And they're all trained by me, and they know exactly what to do. So we're constantly, again, adjusting as we see it. And there's basically only two or three things we do. So we know exactly how to deliver. And you know, every now and then, traffic, you might be late. And you know what happens when you're late? Call them. That's all you got to do. Hey, they know people. There's traffic at the beach during the summer. So if you're going to be a little bit late, the last thing you need is some other having anxiety because the caterer's not there. So there's all these little things you learn.
Okay, last question.
Hello.
Hi, my name is Lynette. I'm from the DBA program. I have a question for you. You're expanding your business and you have good ideas mm-hmm. and surrounded of people. But my question is, what goes in your mind when you want to start one of the businesses? What goes in your mind? The first thing that you think, I can do this.
The first thing is, everybody in my particular business, right? The first thing you did as a surfer in California back in the 80s, the first road trip you took when you got your driver's license and you didn't want to just surf California, you went to Mexico. When you got a little bit more money and you can actually get an airplane ticket, you went to Hawaii. So from a surfer's perspective, the two things that everybody here talks about is the foods they ate on these trips. Today you got Costa Rica, you got other destinations, but in the 80s there were only two. They talked about the fish tacos from Mexico, they talked about the lunch plates that you got on the side of the road in Hawaii. I knew that, and I said, why isn't anybody doing it here? Nobody had the connection. A lot of people knew how to cook, but not everybody had the connection to the surf industry. I was the guy in the middle. So I figured if I can do this, and like they say, a joke is if you build, they'll come. I did, and they came. And as soon as they started coming, I knew I had this niche, because all the surfers go, this is awesome. And as soon as they did the first surf contest, I knew it was over, because I'm like, this is the greatest racket, because nobody wants to do surf contests. There's no money in it. I did it.
Okay, I'm going to let one in because I understand it's a very important question.
Very important.
being a surfer as you, yeah. I just wanted to know what's your favorite surf spot in Southern California?
There's two. I live at 35th Street down at the beach, so I surf 36th Street all the time. If I had more money, I would love to buy a house down at Cotton's Point. It's a private gated community, and if you don't live there, you got to walk in an hour and a half to get to the surf break. It's just the south end of San Clemente. Yeah. So if I had a little more money, that's what I'd do.
Okay. Unfortunately, that brings us to the end of our of our time here. On behalf of the entire university, Wing, thank you so much for a fantastic
You're welcome.